Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone here in the sanctuary and those joining us online. This morning, we are going to begin worshiping and Psalm 122, it says that we are glad to gather together into the house of the Lord, and we are glad to be here this morning to worship and praise Him. And so we gather together to praise the King of Heaven this morning.
Thank you.
We thank you for the salvation that you bring us, Lord, for the things that you do in our lives, Lord, and cause us to rejoice. We thank you, Lord, that you are here with us this morning, and we pray that you continue to be with us in our service this morning, here in this building, Lord, and in our homes. In your name we pray, amen.
Amen.
And we welcome all of you here this morning, everyone joining us online. We encourage you, if you're online, to let us know that you're there by sending an email or logging into Facebook and commenting on the live stream.
Just a few announcements this morning. Remind you of our missionary books that we encourage you to read. There are only three this year, but well worth reading, especially this one. Just stories of what your church is doing around the world regarding human trafficking, which we will be discussing today. We are community. We will finish our mini-series next week as we talk about sharing, the New Testament church sharing, the early Christians getting together, and how we share. One of those ways is through the alabaster offering, which we will receive next week. There we are. An alabaster box, just, it doesn't seem necessary anymore. It seems superfluous. Just not used because so many of us don't use cash. Cindy was talking about some cash that she had. This summer, she opened her wallet and there was a bill in there. I won't tell you the denomination. Not a bill that you have to pay, but one of those paper things that the government puts out that says this is useful money. She had it there for 3 months already. And in September, it was still there. It's just we, as a society, don't use cash as much anymore. So it's hard to gather pennies. Well, we can't gather pennies anymore anyway. Nickels and dimes and quarters and loonies and toonies, they just don't weigh our pockets down as much anymore. And so it's difficult to put change in your alabaster box if you don't have change. But we do want to be faithful to support what is happening in other world areas. And so next week we will receive our alabaster offering, and we just leave that with you. Our first scripture reading this morning, Chloe will read. It's from Isaiah. This portion of scripture, Isaiah 58, will be read in two different sections, and she'll read the first one right now.
Cry aloud. Spare not. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Tell my people their transgressions and the host of Jacob their sins. Yet they seek me daily and delight to know my ways, as a nation that did righteousness and did not forsake the ordinance of their God. They ask of me the ordinances of justice. They take delight in approaching God. Why have we fasted, they say, and you have not seen? Why have we afflicted our souls and you take no notice? In fact, in the day of your fast, you find pleasure and exploit all your laborers. Indeed, you fast for strife and debate and to strike with the fist of wickedness. You will not fast as you do this day to make your voice heard on high. Is it a fast I have chosen, a day for a man to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down his head like a bulrush and to spread out sackcloth and ashes? Would you call this a fast, an acceptable day to the Lord? Is this not the fast that I have chosen, to loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, to let the oppressed go free, and that you break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, and that you bring to your house the poor who are cast out? When you see the naked, that you cover him, and do not hide yourself from your own flesh. Then your light shall break forth like the morning, your healing shall spring forth speedily, and your righteousness shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry, and he will say, here I am.
We are going to sing the hymn, The Love of God, and as the worship team leads in this, I will fix up the display. Thank you.
Then when you pray, God will answer. You'll call out for help, and I'll say, here I am. If you get rid of unfair practices, quit blaming victims, quit gossiping about other people's sins, if you are generous with the hungry and start giving yourself to the down and out, your lives will begin to glow in the darkness, and your shadow lives will be bathed in sunlight. I will always show you where to go. I'll give you a full life in the emptiest of places, firm muscles, strong bones. You'll be like a well-watered garden, a gurgling spring that never runs dry. You'll use the old rubble of past lives to build anew, rebuild the foundations from out of your past. You'll be known as those who can fix anything, restore old ruins, build and renovate, make a community livable again. If you watch your step on the Sabbath and don't use my holy day for personal advantage, if you treat the Sabbath as a day of joy, God's holy day as a celebration, if you honor it by refusing business as usual, making money, running here and there, then you'll be free to enjoy God. I'll make you ride high and soar above it all. I'll make you feast on the inheritance of your ancestor Jacob. Yes, God says so.
He knows my name.
Apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in prayers. Then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Now all who believed were together, and had all things in common, and sold their possessions and goods, and divided them among all, as anyone had need. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. The word of the Lord. Amen.
At this time we would normally receive an offering. I just point out that our offering plates are at the back for those who are with us, and those who aren't can either email their gifts into the church or use one of the two electronic means that we have. Who are we anyway? We'll sing together. Before there was such a thing as the internet, memes were called, well, never mind. I don't want to go there showing my age again. But for what it's worth, I used to clip little sayings of Ashley Brilliant out of the newspaper. That is the paper newspaper. Ashley Brilliant was a cartoonist, and he had great little sayings. And one of those things, and I have a stack of them, of these clippings from a long time. But I have these clippings, and I couldn't find this one. But it says, I can live without the necessities, but I must have my luxuries. Now, everybody's definition of necessity and luxury would be different. Fill in the blank for yourself. I need, what? Faster internet. You always need faster internet. A new car, a new television, a better job, a different job, please. But really, what we consider needs are often just wants. Now, according to psychologists, we all have basic needs. And depending on which study you read, you'll be told how many and what those needs are. One study suggests that there are 7 different basic needs: air, water, food, shelter, safety, sleep, and clothing. Another study says that it's only 5 things: clean air, not just air, but clean air, water, nutrients, shelter, and sleep. But the traditional list is food and water, mixed into one, food and water, shelter, and clothing. Now, I checked with Google, even though Alexa may have all of the answers, I checked with Google just to be sure, and I typed all I need into the search box, and Google came back to me with 22.5 million responses of what I need. And the first 4 pages were song titles. Who'd have figured? So in no particular order, all I need is the air that I breathe. All I need is a miracle. All I need is you. That's by Hillsong, and that was actually the number one answer when you clicked go. All I need is someone to believe in. All I need is a holiday. Frank Sinatra sang, all I need is a girl. All I need is love, saying that, well, actually, the Beatles said, all you need is love. I was cheating there. But when we read that, and this is Acts 2, 44-45, all, that is those who were part of the early church in the New Testament, all who believed were together, they had all things in common, they sold their possessions and goods, and divided them amongst all as anyone has need. And when we read that, we realize that they were sharing what they had with those who did not have those 3 basic needs: food, shelter, and clothing. And they shared them so they would be met. Although I think that safety and freedom could be considered needs. And that leads us to a little problem that I have with today's message. Because today is Freedom Sunday, a day that we pastors are encouraged to talk about one of those things that we don't talk about in the church, or as a society, human trafficking. Now, my problem is that even though standing up for people would fit in very well what was happening in the young church, and they would have spoken up against human trafficking, believe me, just as they spoke up against infanticide or abandoning children to die of exposure on the hillsides, which was prevalent in Greek and Roman societies, that even though it would have fit in well with what was happening with the young church, it doesn't fit in well with the passage of Scripture that we are looking at. And I'm not going to try and shoehorn a topic into a passage of the Bible or force a passage to say what I wanted to say. So we're going to turn a little elsewhere this morning and look at Malachi chapter 3. This is Malachi 3, verse 5. Malachi the prophet, speaking boldly the words of God. I will come near you for judgment. I will be swift witnesses against sorcerers, against adulterers, against perjurers, against those who exploit wage earners and widows and orphans, and against those who turn away an alien because they do not fear me, says the Lord of hosts. God stands against abusers and against those who show a lack of compassion. And can I say, on those who trample human dignity. And God calls his followers, those who have said they are committed to him, he calls them to have a heart for justice, to stand up for those who cannot stand up for themselves. The call to the church is not just to see souls saved, as used to be said, not just to see people find life and hope and forgiveness and love in Jesus, but also to see lives made whole and reclaimed. Jesus cried, how often have I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings. And the cry of the church should be to protect the ones who cannot protect themselves. Now we know that the Bible talks about the care and the cause of widows and orphans and immigrants and the poor, the quartet of the vulnerable, as I've shared over the last few weeks, and shared that it has been expanded by Tim Keller to include the refugee, the migrant worker, the homeless, and the many single parents and elderly people. People who too often cannot look out for or after themselves. We are called to look after them. Now, I could start spewing statistics about how many vulnerable and hurting people live in Canada, live close to us, but I won't. We know that there are problems both seen and unseen. The problems in and of nursing homes have been brought to light by this whole COVID crisis and pandemic. The news cycle won't let us forget them. But what of the homeless? They've been almost forgotten in this. Even in good times now, they're just part of the background that we're used to in our city and in our country. Easy to ignore. And then there are the people who are being trafficked. Slaves, they are, even in Canada. Not just ignored or forgotten, but unseen. Their plight is hidden from our eyes. Now we've heard about the sweatshops in India, and maybe about the ones in Montreal, and we are justifiably indignant. But in 2017, Polaris analyzed one of the largest human trafficking data sets in the United States, and, well, here's what they had to say.
They mow our lawns and vacuum our offices, paint our nails, and paint our houses. They are in the room next door, or the house next door. They're in strip malls where anyone can see them, but most of us don't, because most of us don't know where to look. Until now. In 2017, Polaris analyzed one of the largest human trafficking data sets in the United States. We took the broad concepts of sex trafficking and labor trafficking and broke them down into what they really are, criminal operations within 25 distinct businesses. Now, we know where to find them. Now we can start to understand how they got there, how traffickers work, how the businesses are run. Now, we know. Now, we end it.
Not even aware of everything that goes on around us. It's worse than we thought. We think human trafficking, and perhaps we think the sex trade, perhaps we think the sweatshops, but other than that, Well, more and more we're learning about it, that Barrie, Ontario is a hub in Canada for sex slaves and around the world. And again, I point out the Rollback, our missionary book, read it. And you thought that missions was only about teaching about Jesus or preaching the gospel. It's much more. We are becoming aware and we are becoming more open to admit that slavery is not just a past issue, but it's ongoing today and it's all around us. People are promised freedom if they come to North America, but become indentured slaves once they get here. They've been promised work to help pay their expenses because Canada is the land of the free. But what they're paid is never enough to pay back what they owe. So they never escape. Slaves, trafficked from one world area to another. And it's not just immigrants who are trafficked and become modern slaves, but young people, perhaps, who have run from a bad situation at home or been kicked out of their house. They're easily caught in the trap as well. They have nowhere to turn, and when someone promises to help them, they latch onto it. Before they know it, they're trapped. And as we become aware of what is going on around us, and we better be aware of what is going on around us, we need to speak up. We shouldn't need a proverb to tell us what we should do, that we should do something, to speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves, for the rights of all who are destitute. Speak up and judge fairly. Defend the rights of the poor and the needy. Defend is an action. We should act because we are taken on the mission of Jesus as a church and as individuals. The Jesus who said, God's Spirit is on me. He's chosen me to preach the message of good news to the poor. And that's only where it starts. He has sent me to announce pardon to prisoners and recovery of sight to the blind, to set the burdened and battered free, to announce this is God's year to act, and God acts through us. We don't end with preaching the good news. We take the whole verse to heart. We speak up. We speak out against evil and wrongdoing. We don't ignore it, and we certainly don't justify it. We need to act to defeat it. Now, these are difficult days. They're confusing days. Maybe you see the news or reports or read the news reports of what's happening in Portland and around the states, and you say, that's not right. I have friends that see the riots and say, that's not right, and thinks the police need to be more firm. And I have friends who see the protests and the reaction to the police and say, that's not right, and they say the police are out of control. I have friends that respond to the Black Lives Matter movement and march in solidarity with others. And I have friends that respond to the Black Lives Matter movement by saying, all lives matter and every life matters and blue life matters. And the politics overshadows the church. And the political response overshadows the Christian response. And I've heard people, well, let's just leave the complaints and the counter-complaints and the reactions and the overreactions and the justifications and the... Well, let me just ask you this. What does the Bible say? What does the Bible say? What does the Bible say to us about how we should respond to injustice? The Lord God Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth, the one who made us in His own image, asks, is this not the kind of fasting that I have chosen? To loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free, to break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter? And when you see the naked, to clothe them and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood? So So where has the church been? Where have I been? Have we been? Have I been too quiet? Now I realize that the social net in Canada is better than those of many other world areas, but there are still those who struggle. Statistics might show improvement over the years, but they also show that too many are still caught. Too many are still trapped. We are called to be aware and to act. Why haven't we? Are we showing consent to what is going around us by our silence? Like Solomon Burke's song, he asked, if you don't say it's wrong, then you say it's right. You know, former U.S. Congressman and civil rights leader John Lewis challenged, well, I'd say the people of the United States, but no. He challenged us to confront evil in the world around us, to take a stand against the evil in the world around us, to speak out against the evil in the world around us. And I think that there are two great evils when it comes to human trafficking, which we are looking at just briefly today, just reminding us of it. Two great evils when it comes to evil, to human trafficking. The first is that it exists, that there is such a thing as human trafficking, that people would actually abuse other people by either selling them as slaves or using them as modern-day slaves. First evil. The second is that either we are not aware that it is happening, whether we are willfully blind or not, or that we are aware that it is happening and we're not willing to do anything about it. We'll keep shopping at the stores that are the worst offenders, or buy the products made by the worst offenders. We'll keep talking about freedom, but do absolutely nothing about freeing people. And again, I can give you a list of those who are considered companies that use slaves. Hidden. Nike. Walmart. General Electric. Just for starters. You know, sometimes Christians are no different than those who don't know Jesus. We'll say that we want to make a difference in our world, but when it's going to cost us time or money, when it's going to cost us, then making a difference is not so important anymore. We're all against climate change. We think it's terrible. And we'll do whatever needs to be done to end it or to slow it down. Except we are told that in order to really put a damper on our use of the resources that destroy the world, we would need to double or triple the cost of a liter of gasoline, double or triple the cost of home heating. As we double or triple these things, then it's just natural that foodstuffs, products will rise in price, will double in price or more. And all of a sudden, when it starts to hit us like that, well, maybe climate change isn't such a necessary thing to fight after all, because it's going to really cost us. In many things, we're not willing to pay. This is Malachi 3, verse 5. I will come near to you for judgment. I will be swift witnesses against sorcerers, against adulterers, against perjurers. We're okay with that. Against those who exploit wage earners, which is us when we're buying things made with slave labor. Against widows and orphans, against those who turn away the alien because they do not fear me, says the Lord God. will we sit under judgment? Not because we are sorcerers or adulterers or perjurers, or because we ourselves do the exploiting of wage earners or and widows and orphans, or we don't turn away the alien, but because we don't stand for these exploited people. Will we sit under judgment? That is our question today. Father, help us in these moments of silence and then moments of discussion to hear your voice, we pray.
Take a few moments
in quiet reflection. Prophet Micah, and I've shared before, and those who are old enough to know, Charlie Farquharson, his interpretation of all the prophets was listed in one sentence: you're doing it all wrong. The other side of that is, well, you can't do it right. But the prophet Micah said, he has shown you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God? So justice is not passive. We're not just to think justly or to feel justly, but to take action. So let me ask, how exactly can we enact justice on a daily basis? How do we act justly and bring justice to the forefront? Is it possible? Find out what is happening, but then do something about it. Tomorrow in our Monday musings regarding human trafficking, I'll give a link to an article, 7 things that we can do about human trafficking. And the suggestion is we can do something beyond finding out about it. A further question with justice: how does the ministry of justice overlap with the ministries of evangelism and compassion? We're an evangelical church. We want people to find the peace of Jesus, the forgiveness of sin. How does that mesh with justice? Easy questions, but we've made Christianity too easy in the past days. Ask Jesus to forgive you, go on with your life, to act. Regarding human trafficking, have we been slow to act against it? As Christians, as a church, as a denomination, as a local church? Maybe I should ask, how aware, or are you aware, rather other than hearing about it once a year, the third Sunday of September, are you aware that this human trafficking is going on as much as it is?
Yeah.
I was going to ask a question of you, Nadine, but it would be very unfair of me. So I won't. But so we're aware about it. Have we done anything about it? What can we do again is the question. Research it, find out where it's happening, find out that it is happening. Let other people know that you're aware that it's happening. Are we willing to pay more for the things that we have? So instead of buying that inexpensive shirt that's going to probably fall apart after six washings, but because it's so cheap I'm going to buy it, are we willing to pay more? Are we willing to boycott stores and let them know that we are boycotting them and the reasons why? So, Nadine said, it's difficult to know, and very, very true. I remember when people were saying, don't buy Joe Fresh because they're using slave laborers in Bangladesh. Go to another store. Well, the other store was using the same place. They just put their label on it. It was like someone had a crusade against this one company. So we really need to take time to be more aware of what is going on. And not just latch on to one group, but find out. And that takes time and it takes effort. And Nadine said, it may not be that things are, just because things are more expensive, they're not using slave labor. They're just making more profit. Take effort if we're going to make a difference. But that's the same with anything. If we're going to make a difference in our world, it's going to take time, it's going to take effort, and it's going to cost us. Our question is, are we willing to pay the cost? Are there any thoughts, any other thoughts, any other questions?
I was going to mention that the climate change, against climate change movement, especially regarding fashion, it's a little like classes, just because if you're personally, if you don't have a lot of money, a lot of people will resort to like Joe Fresh and cheaper rent.
true. So sometimes we are in a situation where we cannot afford the higher end clothing that we know is not using slave labor. And so we are trapped, and in our entrapment, we keep other people entrapped. But those of us who can help, it filters down to helping the poor, the impoverished, those who cannot help themselves. And it's going to cost us, or it's going to cost those who can afford to help others out of the traps that they are in. And so if someone is a slave, enslaved in a sweatshop or something, and we're aware of it, it may cost us financially, or it may cost us some time to help lift them out. I'll be honest, unless one of you is working in the sweatshop and hasn't told me, I don't know anybody who is. I don't think. But then again, I do know people who are working for minimum wage and struggling to get by. And to say, well, if they would just go to school or get a better job or whatever, it's just words. If someone doesn't have a hope, or thinks they don't have a hope, and aren't supported and encouraged. And to be honest, I could have found myself in that situation as a young teenager, when I was between grade 11 and grade 12, I left my home. Didn't want to go back to my parents' place. It was not a good situation. So I moved in with a friend. He had an apartment. His landlord found out that I had been there and said, both of you need to leave. And he rented the place to someone else, and someone took me in. And if it weren't for that, I don't know where I would have been. It's because people cared. People invested themselves in me, even though they probably couldn't afford it, but they were willing to. And that obviously has affected me through my life, and I still fail. You probably don't want to hear that your pastor gets selfish sometimes, but we all do. But God speaks to us and challenges us to be more like Him. Loving, compassionate, giving. And I invite you in the next week to look around. Lisa.
I have a comment from somebody watching us on Facebook. They would like to add to the discussion that as we research as individuals, we share our information and try to find ways to support ethical businesses.
Supporting ethical businesses. Very true.
It's not all that difficult to find people who are producing clothing and all that things ethically, because if they are, they're very open about it.
Oh, yes.
But if you go to a fast fashion website or anything like that, you won't see anything about, like, oh, producing, because they're not. And if they were, they would be very open, like, to make sure that people know that this is how we produce our things, and that's why the prices are a bit more expensive, because we put this effort and we pay our workers how we should, we don't cut our prices. Yeah. Even for coffee, just looking for free trade coffee, or looking at where your coffee, if you drink coffee, I don't personally, but just by looking at where it's produced, you can sometimes see ones that are, maybe you'll pay $2 more for your bag of coffee, but you know that it's the people that harvested it, you know, have been paid a living wage.
So it starts with awareness. But before awareness, it starts with us willing to become aware, and then searching, and then those who can afford it, to make sure that you purchase things that are, that you know are not made through a slave trade or through a sweatshop, and then to encourage others or to help others to do that as well. Not easy. We get into habits. Inexpensive coffee, inexpensive clothing.
We're not on Facebook anymore.
All right. All right, so this week, I encourage you, and I challenge you to be aware of what is going on around you. Let's pray together. You've called us to a life of service and a life of love and a life of awareness of the world around us. People need your love. Help us to share that. People need your help. Help us, Lord God, to be your hands and your feet in the days ahead. Keep our eyes and our ears open. Keep our hearts soft. Keep us close to you, we pray, as we go from this place of celebration and worship, in the name of Jesus. Amen. And amen. As you go, go in peace, go in strength, and go in the love of Jesus.
But before we leave, we wanted to say happy birthday to Pastor from the church. So I just keep my distance. I know we can't sing, but we can say the words, happy birthday. So we'll sing together.
Happy birthday to you. Okay.
You
have to say it several times. I'm going to sing in the song, we'll sing in the song. Okay. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Christ. Happy birthday to you.
Thank you all.